Again, thank you very much for joining us. It's been a remarkable celebration, and I hope you have had been inspired and encouraged and enjoyed the celebration as certainly as well as I have. A few quick opening remarks. A dear friend of mine, Jim Ray, is here, as is John Rakes, and they have taken pictures throughout the conference. They will all be available to you free on the internet. So if you've seen a lot of pictures, that's a wonderful gift NCDA hopes to give back to you. You've seen many of the pictures in the rolling slideshow, but NCDA wants to do many things to thank you. It's been a party and a celebration, and that's a gift we can give back. In addition, if I could ask, please, will all the Leadership Academy graduates and present Leadership Academy individuals stand, please, to be acknowledged as part of the Leadership Academy? Please, would you stand? Thank you. As you know, this is a celebration, and we've also initiated the Second Century Initiative to try to support our financial and leadership preparedness and sustainability. So as you will learn after this conference, if you haven't heard already, you'll be asked to consider how you might give back to the Second Century Initiative as well. And one of our goals clearly is to advance leadership preparedness, so we welcome the opportunity to hear from all of you should you have interest in leadership development as we grow that program. I also want to say that if you found this conceptual nature of this conference useful, and certainly the content sessions and themes, I want to acknowledge a remarkable planning train as well. I appreciate that as well. It's great when they come in at the right time, and that was a celebration of the late birthday candle that we just blew out, so thank you. The conceptual nature of this conference began about 2 years ago in Ottawa on a napkin with the gentleman sitting to my right. Much of the idea for this conference and the intellectual support for what we've tried to do is brought to you by a remarkable individual we'll all get to hear from. The challenge with having a great member and presenter and researcher and scholar and inspirer is you never can find a room big enough for them at a conference. So the way we handle that is to close our wonderful celebration after 100 years with the person that we know has stimulated, befriended us, and inspired every one of us in this room. The thinker of the generation, I feel, in our field that certainly pushed many of us. Dr. Mark Savickas is the creator of the career construction theory and the career style interview, two landmark ideas regarding how people view career identity and job satisfaction in the 21st century. He has written over 80 articles, 40 book chapters, and given over 500 presentations where there rarely was a seat left at the end of the presentation. He currently serves as professor of behavioral sciences at the Northeastern Ohio Medical University and as adjunct professor of counselor education at Kent State University. He's the editor of numerous journals and has won awards in the national and international areas. And if you learn to work with Mark, he says, please keep that interview short. It's not about what I've done, it's about how I'm present with us today. There's a giant in this room, and I welcome him, Dr. Mark Savickas.
That's too much. Thank you. Thank you. Rich is overly kind. Last night and this morning, I had about 25 people say good luck. And I kept thinking, what am I doing that needs good luck? You know? And one person, Rich Feller, says, not good luck. He said, what can I do to help you? That's Rich. So thank you for the privilege of speaking today, and thank you for joining us in this closing session. And Alberto the other day said, give me a preview of your talk. I said, well, these three slides will be the whole talk, but it'll take a little longer. The trouble with our times is that the future isn't what it used to be. Yep. But the quote's from 1938. And the second slide, Alberto, the future needs a past. For us to plan our best possible future, we have to take stock and look at where we've been and what we've learned. And from our great social philosopher, Ferris Bueller, life moves pretty fast, and what we're doing at this conference and this morning is stop and take a look around. And of course, from my perspective, when I look around at career story, look at the narrative. And so what I want to discuss this morning and get your reaction to is, instead of looking at a client's story, I want to look at NCDA story, the career field story, for the last 100 years as we approach the next 100 years. And of course, as we all do, I know that the self that a person makes themselves into is a function of language. If you don't have a word for it, you don't have it. I read in a memoir of a young girl who in Russia was learning English, and she came across the word privacy and asked the tutor, "What does that mean?" And the tutor says, "Don't worry, we don't have that." Okay? So career profession is also a function of language. We live in language as individuals and as our community of professionals. And we have this common goal of fostering career development. And the way we move towards our goal is we've constructed our own special vocabulary, our own ways of thinking, and our methods of working. And they all begin with words. And the first person to try and put a word on our field was Lysander Richards from Boston, 1881, said, "The world needs people to help people choose vocations. And that science is vocaphy, and you are vocaphers." Didn't catch on. 1908, Parsons coined the word vocational guidance, but in the first career counseling training course at Harvard University, the textbook was Lysander Richards' vocaphy. Through the repetition of words and practices, we gave substance to our field. We created our boundaries, our norms, and as new people enter the profession at universities, they learn to talk RIASEC and other things. So in addition to a stock of words that we share together, we have genres that embody our knowledge and our ways of acting. And a genre, as you know, is just a social construction that defines a particular field, gives us some legitimacy, and gives us our identity. And on the occasion of our centennial, I want to listen closely to our stock of words and the genres that bind us together. To me, each person in this room is a novel, and you represent one of three main genres, ways of thinking, working, and speaking that we use together. I drew on a field called the study of English for specific purposes because it's designed to help you study a field. And what you look at is repeated phrases, dominant themes, exemplary quotations, preferred explanation, you know, Holland's birds of a feather flock together, and test and tell, and supers, vocational choices, implementation of a self-concept. We have a bunch of quotes, a bunch of favorite phrases. The lexicon, Bob McCarter was kind enough to give me the convention program ahead of time. These are the 100 most used words in the catalog of this convention. The bigger the word, the more it appeared. So you can see our most common words, career, development, but there's other words. There's theories, there's veterans, discover, create, clients, challenges. This is our language. This is how you speak career. And I wanted to see what patterns of genre this language coalesces into over the last 100 years. And by going through the 100 years of our journal, I identified four patterns. You might identify three, you might identify 10, but the four I found fit the different periods in American history: our farm era, our industrial era, our corporate era, and our digital era. So when we were on farms in the 19th century economy, we had people performing chores. They didn't have jobs. They had chores at 8 a.m., they had chores at noon, they had chores different months. And everybody was to be the same. Everybody was to have a good character. You were all to be honest. You were all to be altruistic. You were all to be hardworking. And character means stamp, like you stamp a picture on a coin. So the community stamps character on you. But with the Industrial Revolution, the future isn't what it used to be. And Thomas Carlyle, who was a very famous and popular philosopher until Hitler said he was his favorite writer, and that was the end of Carlyle. But Carlyle, he had a good run. But He had in his book in 1860, people's creeds, beliefs, and institutions are all in tatters because of the enormous advances of modern thought and science, and they have to be tailored anew for a new era. So his book is called Sartor Restartus, which means tailor, the cloth maker, the tailor retailored. And he says, to each is given a certain inward talent, a certain outward environment of fortune, to each by wisest combination of these two, a certain maximum capability. Sound good for 1860? But the hardest problem, wherever this first, to find by study of yourself and the ground you stand on, what your combined inward and outward capability specially is, long before Parsons. And the words that they used was friendly visits. After the Civil War, the Chicago YMCA gave counseling to 450 veterans, but they didn't call it counseling, they called it a friendly visit. And for 50 years, some YMCAs, the members would get together on a Saturday and travel to a neighboring town and sit down in the library and meet with young people in a friendly visit. And they talked about calling and capability and information, used palmistry and phrenology, and talked about pursuits. But that was the way it went, especially with the law of primogeniture, and you were the second born. You didn't get the farm. You had to have something else. But with modernization, with the second part of the Industrial Revolution, we again had enormous changes, with rapid change in technology. We now had markets. The first applied psychology was advertising, so you could sell your goods in neighboring cities. You know, before in the village, you didn't have to advertise. That's why many of the founders of the field were salespeople in advertising. E.K. Strong was a professor of business. Most of his books were on advertising. So, and religion was replaced as the key explainer of things by science. So this is what caused, in 1900, the shift to industry. Industrialization, urbanization, immigration. By 1910, more than half of Americans for the first time lived in the city. Coincidentally, by 2010, more than half the people in the world live in cities. And in the cities, you didn't have chores, you had a job. And the jobs had to be made to be efficient and standardized and uniform. So we had this field called industrial design, work design. Europe, they still call it Fordism or Taylorism. Taylor was writing books on how to make the jobs as efficient as possible. The one best way was his saying, the one best way to lay a brick. And he called first class man, not first class person. We've got to find first class people to do it the one best way. His successor became Lillian Gilbreth, who became the first industrial organizational psychologist, the first lady of management, and one of the first female engineers. And coincidentally, she had 12 kids. She ran her house using that work design methods, and her kids wrote a book that was made into the movie Cheaper by the Dozen. Not the Steve Martin thing that doesn't do it, but the original one with Clifton Webb. And that picture of her house, guess who lived right next door? Paul Super and his son, Donald. What a coincidence, what a coincidence. Urbanization, the cities exploded. In the 1890s, the people in New York City doubled. The same was in Boston and other places. And when you came to the city, character wasn't as important. And Virginia Woolf, looking back in 1938, said, on or about December 1910, human nature changed. 1910, the Pope wrote an encyclical against modernism. 2010, the Pope wrote an encyclical against social constructionism. So in the city, it wasn't about character, it was putting on a mask, a persona. It was your adaptive response to living in the carnival or circus, as cities were called. And we invented, 1927 was the first book on personality theory. If you look back before, it was about character. Personality is how you are an individual, how you are different from others. And in the city, as an individual, without that warm, loving village community holding you, many people were lost. Friendly visits weren't working so well, and the children in the streets needed saving. So the social workers started this thing called child saving, which morphed into vocational guidance. The way we saved them is to try and get them to work that fit their personality. Parsons wrote, "The vital problem of vocational choice should be solved in a careful, scientific way." That's why he's considered the pioneer. Not that he was the first one to think of matching or helping, but applying science, or as he said, true reasoning. Edward Lee Thorndike, 1911, published his revolutionary book called Individuality. He's saying, hey, people are different. School teachers were the first to recognize that there were individual differences. And so the root of our field became measuring scientifically individual differences. D.G. Patterson, you can see the quote, his first World War picture. The interesting aside is his best student was Darley, and Darley's best student was Holland. So this is the beginning of the Minnesota scientific point of view. Parsons then establish vocational guidance. I won't retell the story, but I do have a copy of the original book with the dust jacket on it. And if you study it carefully, which I did for the first time last night, I saw he's the author of a book called, Youth in the City, and I can't even read it now, Youth in the World. But I have a copy of that book because Chris Brittick got a manuscript of it from the Yale Library, and it has chapters on interests and other things, but it was never published. So our first counseling staff at the Bureau, Ralph Albertson, the personnel director at Filings, Lucinda Wyman Prince, who formed quickly a school of sales school for women and had a huge successful career. And Philip Davis, a Harvard social worker who lived on the top floor of that La Familia restaurant that some of you went to. This is a picture of a School for Citizenship lecture on that top floor of that building. And this isn't Parsons lecturing in 1908, but it probably looked like this. It probably looked very similar when the first vocational guidance was done. Don't want to give credit to all men, right? We had Lillian Gilbreth, and the field was established in Great Britain by Maria Gordon, a great scientist. And in 1908, a year before Parsons, she wrote a book on a handbook of employments, which probably is the first modern book in our field. And her champion was a young lion named Winston Churchill, who on her behalf sponsored a bill in Parliament called the Labor Exchange Act, which established juvenile employment offices all over the world. Sometimes women are anonymous, right? It's not Parsons, Parsons, Parsons. There's other people. This matching thing has turned into vocational guidance, personnel selection, military classification, and this young military recruit, John Howland, says that his job was to interview people and classify them. And that after he did a couple hundred, he was filling in the forms before they responded, because he saw the patterns. And what he did to our field, he took what we called matching and gave it a theory, a theoretical explanation. He took Spranger's six value types, you can see theoretical, Guilford's vocational stereotypes, scientific, and he called it what? You fail. Investigative, come on. How about economic and mechanical? Realistic, all right. Somebody, who passed? Raise your hand, I want to see. Oh, no scholars on this side of the room. Crumbolts, come on, wake up. Let's get going here. Okay. And for each one, he wrote an Adlerian type lifestyle. And so today we have the science of resemblance. We have a beautiful theory, we have a technology, and what guidance is to take a lost person, say, this is who you resemble, you look like realistic, you look like social, and these are the people you should work with. I hope you find this charming. This is Parsons and Holland's college graduation pictures. This is what they look like when they needed guidance. So. The theory went from being called matching to trait and factor, today person environment fit theory. And this is its general model. It's to get self-knowledge, information, match the two. The genre is vocational guidance, to look at an actor in the world as an object and see the enduring inside traits of personality and match them to environments where people like them reside. Here's the words. Can you read? How far back? Who can't read? What role cannot read? You can all see? I'm good. You see the words. That's our word stock. And there's an epistemology, there's a philosophy behind this. Pepper called it formism. And formism categorizes, classifies things. It says, what is it like? And it's looking for the metaphor of resemblance, similarity. And the truth criterion is, it corresponds. It's realistic. So we have an underlying philosophy of science that we never talk about. However, after World War II, I got ahead of myself. During the first half of the century, there was increasing work design standardization, first grade, second grade, third grade, assistant professor, associate professor. We made, through state activities, through institutions, things more and more standard. And sociologists call this the first demographic transition. So that by 1960, most people were following the sequence and order and timing of the life course that society suggested, the meta-narrative. This tightening sequence brought males and females' life stories closer together, and it did the same with racial, economic, and other groups. But of course, there was great inequality by gender, ethnicity, and race, and social class. But still, we were being standardized as much as possible, so much that Erickson could say, here's the story of your life. Where are you now? What are you dealing with now? Okay? After World War II, the soldiers came home and didn't recognize their cities. The cities had changed. We now had bureaucracies and corporations and middle class and suburbs, and there was a break with the industrial assembly line. People believe that a society is disintegrating when it can no longer be pictured in familiar words. Unhappy is a people that has run out of words to describe what is going on. And our guidance lexicon ran out of words. Our practice was disrupted, and we had to reposition ourselves. When corporations ruled the world, a new thing appeared that wasn't there before: career. Career is the value of hierarchical corporations and bureaucracy. You climb their ladder. Before a hierarchy, you don't have a career, you have a job, okay? So industrial assembly lines then were augmented by the ladder, climbing the ladder. And Super told us how to climb the ladder. And of course, he took it from a woman, Charlotta Bueller, the first humanistic psychologist, the first lady of humanistic psychology. Her, Adler, and Freud applied for the same job at the University of Vienna, and she got it. Their super story told by Super's pictures. Wasn't he charming? What a head of hair. Whoa. Yeah, looking good, Don. And Don and John, Jack and others, helped to rename our journal from Vocational Guidance to Career Development. Of course, Holland and Weinreich wrote an essay in memoriam. You know, they were not happy. They were not happy. So for high modernity, we have the main theory, career development, articulated best by Don and our dear friend Sonny. Please send out some good thoughts. As you know, she had a little stroke the other night, and Taurus at the hospital now, hoping to be able to take her home. So the model then, after World War II, with Super and Sonny, is called career education and coaching. They sometimes call it career counseling, but it's not. It's coaching, it's psychosocial education. You assess the developmental situation or the problem being faced, what comes next, and how to get the person ready. The genre is career education and coaching. It's about the agent, not the actor, but you as an agent in your own life, you directing you, getting more control. Bob would say more self-efficacy, the sense of agency to direct yourself as an actor. And look at the lexicon. See how the words are different? You see how in our different sessions there was different language going on? See the different novels in the room who speak one language better than another? To some, this is like French. What the hell does that mean, right? They speak guidance. So the more languages you speak, the better off you are. The underlying epistemology is not formism, it's organism. It's about the how does something develop? What stages does it grow through? And the goal, the criterion is unity, individuation, wholeness, completeness. See how it has even a different epistemology. By the 1970s, some say by 1973, the oil crisis changed everything. So we've had increasing standardization, increasing uniformity, and then we had those wild 70s. How many lived through the 70s? How many remember the 70s? Yes, David, don't blush. It's okay. We forgive you. That's okay. And so there became, we thought, freedom, freedom, freedom. But by the 1990s, we said, oh, this deregulation is leaving us lost again because it's about complexity and diversity of the individual. We lost the grand pattern. We lost the grand story. And now it's about the individual. Individualization, not digitalization. Individualization is the key characteristic of our postmodern society. Things that had become institutionalized are gone because those institutions are gone, right? Those grand big corporations are gone. So we've moved from follow the script to what is your story? What is your story? How are you doing it? And so when young people and middle-aged changers and retirees look at the script, they now find it's less predictable, less regulated, less stable, less orderly, more confusing, and they need us again, like they needed us in 1910 desperately, like they needed us after World War II desperately. They need us again because it's confusing. The post-corporate society is globalized. We have world workers. Your children are working in China and Japan, and we have even at this conference people from countries who 20 years ago would never even think of coming. So work has become distributed. It's changed. You can work at home sometimes. You can work in McDonald's sometimes. The organizations are disappearing, and it's all about organizing and networking because they've been downsized, flattened, restructured, and guess what went with them? Career ladders. Now we are looking for, Henry Ford said, why do I have to hire the whole person? I just want their hands. He'd be very happy today because all you get is their hands. The psychological contract used to be a relationship. We'll do this together for 30 years. I'll give you a pension. I'll give you health care. I'll take care of you. I'll hold on to you. Now it's do this project, do this job, and I'll talk to you in 6 months. How many are adjunct professors? You can teach this course if it fills. Yeah? Pension? What are you kidding? Health insurance? Obama will take care of that, okay? So we're now jobless. And remember we had chores, went to jobs. Now it's all about projects. The best metaphor I know for it is making a movie. You hire 300 people for 3 years, they make a movie, the movie debuts, hopefully it does a little better than the Lone Ranger's doing, right? And what happens to those 300 workers? Find a new project. Find a new project. Read this, it takes your breath away. 1 in 4 workers has been with their current employer for less than a year. 1 in 2, less than 5 years. The psychological contract is no longer a relationship, it's a transaction. It's true in all Western countries. 2/3 of German young workers have fixed-term contracts. Fixed-term contracts. So to our old model, we add the bullseye. The bullseye is the 40% of us in the room who have tenure track stable jobs with insurance and pensions and are very lucky, surrounded by 40% of vulnerable workers who are at risk and called insecure, surrounded by 20% who are looking because their jobs have been outsourced. Their jobs have been sent somewhere else. So our dream is to get in the center of that bullseye, right? That's our dream. Employees today, temporary, contingent, casual, contract, freelance, part-time, external, atypical, adjunct. Mobile employee, you want an office? Good luck with that. You know, in the old days, the bigger the office, it was a sign of prestige. Today, it's hoteling, hot desking, floating off, first come, first serve. The one thing you get for sure is one file drawer with a lock to keep your stuff in and move it to the next place. University professors who are now teaching online, how long do you think you're going to have your office? We're talking about brickless universities. Back in 1910, with this huge change, on the farm you had puberty at 14, 16 you were married, 17 you had a family, okay? Came to the city, had puberty at 13, at 20 you were married, had a family. Now, they had that, so they invented adolescence. Now, the new life stage is emerging adulthood, okay? Have puberty at 12, and you finally settle in, 28, 29, 30, right? The TV show Friends is about emerging adulthood, okay? And we have so many youth that are called neat, not in Adobe Gillis Beatnik sense, but in not in employment, not in education, not in training. 1 million neat youth in England, Turkey, Mexico, Italy, and Greece. They're called the United States rebound children. They graduate from, they got their MBA and they're living in your basement, okay? In Japan, Agnes, I've heard they're called parasite children, okay? So there's a decline in the story. There's a decline in the identifiable paths, but people have to go on anyway. And what this is called by the sociologists, we are now living in this second demographic transition, this individualization when the script we're to live is vague and uncertain. In 1960, 77% of men, 65% of women had by age 30 done these five things, usually in that order. By 2000, 30% less. I don't have a number for 2013, but I'm sure it's less. The script is gone. We have new behaviors, living with parents, living alone, unmarried cohabitation, out of wedlock births. I love that word, out of wedlock. You know, what does society do? Wedlock, somebody found a key, right? Yeah. So in 2006, for the first time in U.S. history, a majority of births were to unwed women. Okay? That's not your grandma's story, right? It's not your grandma's story. So the normative timetables that have organized lives, or we could in career education say, explore, establish, maintain, they're gone. This is the second meaning of the word career. Path. And it's what Don and Sonny talked about. Your life rolls through a life path. But this poem says it best, this great Spanish poem. Today, traveler, your footprints are the path and nothing more. Traveler, there is no path. The path is made by walking. Or Tom Petty's version, it's hard to say who you are these days, but you run on anyway. It's making people responsible for their lives. The corporation isn't taking care of you. The institutions that took care of your grandparents and parents are dissipating. Look at the churches, look at the schools, look at the colleges, look at the institutions and see how well they're doing. So today, we don't have a path, we have boundaryless careers, we have protean careers, we have kaleidoscope careers, we have portfolio careers, customized careers, subjective careers. There's a book on all those if you want to spend your money. Phil Jarvis talked about career management. You can't develop, a child develops in a warm, holding environment where the family keeps the acts together. The corporations used to give us the stability, the medium in which we can develop. Since they're gone, there isn't career development. There is management. Manage your life. And Phil says career management is a lifelong quest to construct one's best possible future. And you do it not by deciding, not by making that one choice and living it for 30 years. You do it by lifelong learning and growing and becoming. So today, career has returned to its first meaning, which was cart, carriage, chariot, car. Career is the carrier of meaning. It's your life story. It's what carries you through. Subjective career carries meaning that provides the stability that you need, the internal guidance, and allows you to make decisions. But our first genre of career, vocational guidance, and our second genre of career education weren't designed to talk about individualization. And it has caused, again, us as a field to say the future's not what it used to be. Okay, for that 40% in the center, we can use guidance and education and coping. But what about that 40% of vulnerable? What about that 20% of invisible? It's about uniqueness now, not about resemblance, not where do you fit, who do you look like, not follow this story that we're giving you. It's about you alone figuring it out. This first became apparent to me in 1992 when at the end of the first SVP conference where John gave one of the best talks I have ever heard, Arnie got up and said, we do not have career counseling theories. Holland's not about career counseling, it's about career development, vocational behavior. Super's not about counseling. In fact, I don't know if either one of them ever did much counseling. It's not about what we need today. Individual differences don't tell us about individuals. Individual differences don't tell us, Kevin, who you are. They tell us, here's his IQ, he's at the 90th percentile. What does that mean to a person? Person cares about purpose, not their percentiles. So the great individual differences technology doesn't serve us well when we're talking about uniqueness. We have colleagues in this room and across the world who are trying to respond with counseling theories. The first to me being David Tiedemann, where his saying, the career is the imposition of meaning on vocational behavior. Beautiful. Career is the imposition of meaning on vocational behavior. Crumbrough said, it's just happenstance that I had this picture, but, you know, and we have, you know, Mary Sue Richardson and relational theory. And then we have great leaders of NCDA who are writing and teaching and leading the field to career dealing with the 21st century and individualization with Lisa writing about career story and David Volition. Carol has a brand new book. She's so humble she doesn't want to advertise it. Carol, what's the name of your book? Are you here? What's the name of your book? I can't hear. Yeah, don't take my whole talk. Yeah. And we have counselor educators like Hartung and Tracy Laura and Pam Brott and teaching new generations of professors to be about this. It's not just the United States. Peavy, Amundsen, Young, Bougeau, Chen are in Canada working on the same problem. And we have who are these guys? We have Bright and Pryor, McMahon in Australia, and we have Hazel Reed and Jenny Bimrose in England, and in South Africa, Mark Watson, Cobus Marie, all in their own way, in their own lexicon, doing what we're talking about. We need models of counseling for individualization and uniqueness. And of course, my favorite group in Europe, but we leave them alone. So individualization of life course, I believe the people we serve need two meta competencies, two big, huge sets of skills and attitudes, adaptability and identity. Identity to know their story and adaptability when to change chapters, how to change chapters. We've moved from Super and Sonny's maturing and readying and unfolding to adapting to a context. Help people deal with their own development, adaptability, and there's a lot in our journals happening, a lot of new inventories and techniques. But here's some of the words: employability, not employment, lifelong learning, career capital, flex security. Don't you love that? Not security. your securities and being flexible. Flex security, you know, job crafting, career preparedness. Bob loves preparedness, cultural competence. Okay, see the new words? Parsons couldn't speak this language, didn't need to. And from character to personality, now it's identity. Identity, as Bluestein says, Bluestein, excuse me. He loves me to call him Bluestein as a special treat. Ask him why. Self in role is identity. And you have many roles, so you have multiple identities in different contexts. You don't have a stable, enduring set of traits that's your personality, okay? You're different people, different identities in different situations. I love Ibarra at Yale's phrase, working identity. Means your vocational identity, your identity as a worker, but you're always working on identity. The philosopher Giddens says, identity is that capacity to keep your life story going when the jobs and the changes cause problems. So things are changing so fast that people are losing a sense. Some people are still waiting for the recovery from the housing crisis. You know, others are talking about the new normal. And in this uncertain world, the only certainty is what you make inside yourself and with those you love, with your family, your community. It's no certainty. And even at your university, your college, there's no certainty except in you, your heart, and relationships. So we have to help people make sense of their lives. And here's the identity lexicon. I love from Germany, biographicity, autobiographical reasoning to make transitions. When you lose a project and it's the movie's done and it's time to move, make the change based on your story. And life designing, narratability, help people be able to say out loud, this is who I am, this is what I want, this is where I'm going. Meaning making, mattering, doing something that matters to other people, calling, volition. Do you see the different words? Look through the convention program and you see these words, you see this stock of words. And the big words to me are career story. And he hasn't been here for 3 years, but David, stand up and wave. David came to celebrate the 100th anniversary. And he just wanted to join us. And one of the best, greatest things I ever learned at NCDA was in David's 1990 presidential address, when he first was the first one I ever heard talk about career as story. So thank you, David. When people seek counseling, they have a story to tell. And stories tell us as we tell them. That's why we're listening. That's why we're listening. What are the words? What are the genres? So life design, for me, is an umbrella term. You call it what you want. But it's identity interventions that try and move not to decidedness, but to intention and action through storytelling. And the general model, instruct, reconstruct, co-construct, action. Career is a story. We get small stories from them. We listen to what's going on. We deconstruct terrible ideas about racism and sexism and homophobia so that we can open new doors that had been closed by bad scripts people had given to them. And after this, we reconstruct it into one grand story of you. This is a portrait of you right now. This is your identity. And together, counselor and client, co-construct a new episode, a new chapter in the life to be that revises identity, sets priorities, and provides a sense of calling and what you call for that creates action in the real world. Action, because through action, you make a new self, shape your identity, and construct your career. It fits Kolb's learning cycle. People have a concrete experience and they come with some feeling. You notice that the new models all talk about emotion, anxiety, uncertainty. The old model was rational, all about thinking. They feel something, they have a tension. And together, reflective observation, we look at that tension. We pay attention to the tension. And eventually, that attention can turn through abstract conceptualization into constructing a life portrait, into intention. And then the last step is the doing, the extension. It's a beautiful model that fits all the work that I read lately. Tension, attention, intention, extension. So, life design, let's construct a career story, reconstruct an identity narrative, co-construct intentions and prompt action. Here's the lexicon you've already seen on other slides. The genre I like to call career counseling because it's been misused for so long. That's why we come up with life designing. You know, life design, it's counseling, but we want to call your attention to, you know, too many years career education and career development has been called counseling. It's coaching, it's education, it's wonderful, but it's not counseling. And the epistemology underneath is contextualism. How does this happen? Let's look at action in context, and the truth criterion, does it work? The old pragmatic effectiveness. So, the trouble with our times is that the future's not what it used to be. And so we're creating this new genre for the 21st century that pays attention to uniqueness and individualization through counseling. Career counselors are first counselors. You're not first career, you're counselor who decides to look at career issues. So we have our wonderful dance of career services. Unfortunately, at my university, each of these is in a different office. The students can't find, dance around and don't end up with a good partner. So we have the Formis guidance and advising. Great services, aren't they? Great services. We have the organismic education and coaching, unbelievably helpful. And we have the contextual counseling and design. They're all great. They're all wonderful when used with the right person at the right time, right? Some people think I'm against vocational guidance. Guidance and advice is fabulous at the right time, not when the person is struggling with transforming their personal identity. You know, what advice you got for me? So we have these three great genres. And different people in this room write books and study and practice in one genre. Some do two, some do three. Yes? Yes? Niles, yes or no? What do you think? Wake up, will you? Come on. Colosi, punch him one, will you? So we have vocational guidance for the actor's fit, for the actor's fit. And we don't pay enough attention to what we're really contributing to society. It's not just guidance and advice. These people, they're lost. They feel alone. They don't know what to do. And they meet with you or they take your class and they go away with a sense of direction and a sense of, I'm welcome. This is where I belong. It's a great, great healing force. And it's to get people moving, to join with us together. Career education is for adaptation, for making the next move. People are undecided, stuck, paralyzed, don't know what they can do, don't know if they can move, should they move, where are they allowed to move, and they talk with you, and they leave eventually with the confidence and the competence and the courage to make the next move. What a service, what a service. And career counseling, life design, they're in trouble. They're in trouble. We've all been in trouble or a transition. And we sit down and make them listen to their heart beating, to what's at stake in their own life. And we help them use their own authority to author a move in a new direction. What a service. What a service. So NCDA, we are celebrating us, not some abstract organization. We're celebrating the person sits next to you because our mission, what we do that matters, is assist society adapt to social transitions in the world of work, the way work's changing, and at the same time, assist individuals adapt to personal changes in the world of work. And we meet them when their trouble with their time is their future doesn't look like it used to be. And this, to continue the metaphor of lexicon and jargon, to me, this conference is like a community library. Each person in front of me is a novel, is an expert book that I can read to learn and to grow and learn new words from you, create new things like privacy or mattering, and create a return to read our classic stories, our classic, to hear about Parsons and Holland and Kitson, and then to learn about new genres. So at this conference, at this community of professionals, at this library of lives, the ancient Greek library had over the front door a place of healing. This is a place of helping and healing. And we ourselves get advice and guidance about problematic issues in our own lives, in our practice, in our institutions that move us forward to solutions. We get education and coaching about new approaches and innovation, new things we can try to move our practice in a new direction towards those who need us most. And we get good counsel and inspiration that as we leave today, deepens our commitment and fuels our passion. So I want to thank, like everybody in the room, wants to thank the team that put this special place together, but especially Rich Feller for his big heart and for his opening his own life for the last 3 years for us to join in together. But more than Rich and more than the organization, I want us to thank each other for coming together and revitalizing our own lives. Thank you.
We just heard the story of what the second century looks like. We've just seen the painting of the landscape within which we each work, cry, and smile. We just heard the heartbeat of NCDA's opportunities. Mark, you've helped all of us feel more alive today. Whether we felt to be needed to be inspired or reinvented, you touched who we are. You've helped launch NCDA into our next century better than anyone could possibly do. And you've helped us better understand what legacy really means. You've brought it to the core of why we talk about what we do as a social justice issue. And we've talked enough to understand that without hope, we don't have a future. We close this celebration and we honor ourselves as a community with much to be done. I can't think of a better way to end this day than to appreciate each other and to thank Mark for helping us to see what this is all about. Thank you again, Mark. I don't know if those statements are meaningful, but I wrote them in 3 minutes. Because if you live in the present, you live with understanding of how Mark lives his life and how he sees the importance of legacy and hope in the combination of the two. Let's close this celebration by thanking Deneen Pennington and her staff, which is such a small staff that makes us look awful big. Thank you very much, Deneen. Let me please ask Lisa Severy to join the stage. As you may know, Lisa is a remarkable person in her own right in her own career, but she also is the program coordinator of this whole experience. So we'd thank you and owe you a great debt.
Thank you.
We also want to We also want to move on quickly to the second century and to pass on this gavel with a great sense of joy to a woman who I wish was my sister. She is a good friend as you could have and inspires me every day about the quality of persons we all can be. It's a joy to work with you. Congratulations.
Thank you. Really not fair to ask people to cry and then get up and talk. thank you. I feel it's just been an amazing week. And honestly, while I'm not surprised about the breadth and the depth of information we've shared through members and even in conversations in the hallway, I have to say, most impressive. I was very impressed with this group's dancing last night. Pleasantly surprised by that as well. So I hope you've enjoyed it as much as I have. Believe it or not, we're already in the planning stages. Hopefully you've seen our logo for next year's conference. We are excited about that as well. In Long Beach, California, the 19th through the 21st, there's some videos online about Long Beach. I hope you take advantage of those. Most importantly, I hope you'll think about, for those of you who presented, what you'll present next year, and for those of you who haven't had the opportunity to share your best practices and the things that you bring to this community, that you'll do that as well. Finally, I would also like to take a moment to recognize the phenomenal leadership of Rich Feller. While this week's conference has been very, very public, and you've seen his leadership, the whole year has been a landmark year for the organization, and it's come to the next level under his leadership. To have him as a colleague and a friend is an honor. So please join me in thanking Rich Feller. With that, I bid you all farewell, safe travels, and we'll see you in Long Beach next year. Thank you very much.